Welcome back to a course on calculus RS integration. The next theorem that we are going to see is called as change of variable. And this theorem states that suppose phi is a strictly increasing continuous function that maps a comma b onto ab, and let us further suppose alpha monotonically increasing on the closed interval a comma b, and f is Riemann Stieltjes integrable with respect to alpha on the interval a comma b. Further, we define beta and g on the closed interval big A comma big B, which is defined by beta of y as alpha of phi of y, and g of y as f of phi of y. Then we'll have to prove your g is Riemann Stieltjes integrable with respect to the function b on the interval big A comma b, and your integral g d beta over the interval big A comma b is same as that of integral a to b f d alpha. If you remember from the ideologies that we have spoken in the previous lectures, you may very well see that these integral values are some finite values. So whether you integrate this function or that function over this interval or that interval, that is not a bother. You are going to get a value. Here we are saying that these two values has to be equal, right? Now let us see the proof of this theorem. Okay, given alpha is strictly increasing. So when it is strictly increasing, it means what? Whenever you take strictly increasing means whenever you take x less than y, this would give you, sorry, this is not alpha, right? This is phi. Given alpha, phi is strictly increasing. So whenever you are given it is strictly increasing, your x smaller than y will imply alpha of x strictly smaller than alpha of y. If it is simply given to be increasing one, we may have equality here. The equality is not on. Equality is not included. Okay. So whenever this is going to happen, this very well tells us that whenever you take two different things, whether it is x smaller than y or x bigger than y, but it is not equal to y. So whenever you take x not equals y, this implies your phi of x not equals phi of y. Okay. With which we conclude your phi is, so one function defined on the interval a comma b, and it is also given that it is an onto function. Right. Now, we are about to choose partitions to these intervals. P star be the partition of the interval small a comma b. This is a partition on AB, and PB some partition, that is big A equals y naught, y one, y two, etc. till yn, which is we are considering two partitions p star and p, which consist of same number of elements. I am not saying same elements, they are same in number, same number of elements be that of, this is a partition of big A comma P. Okay, since phi is continuous by intermediate value theorem, we can have your phi of yi is xi for I runs from 1 to n. So in this manner, p and p star are chosen. Right, now let us consider u partition p g b. This is what summation I runs from 1 to n m I star delta beta I. Let us mark this as equation 1. Here your m, big M I star, is nothing but supremum of g of y, where y takes the values in the sub interval yi minus 1 comma yi. What is your g of y? It is defined to be, your g of y is defined to be f of phi of y. Right, just now we have seen that by intermediate value theorem your phi of yi can be written as xi for all these things. Again, using the intermediate value theorem, we may identify some point, corresponding point to this thing, okay, where this x will lie between xi minus 1 comma xi. Okay, here we will pay some attention and see what is actually happening here. Supremum means supremum of this function. Your y takes value in this interval, and we have said that phi of yi is xi for I runs from 1 to n. So this is what we have said. At these n points, this is same. This is what we have said. Okay, when your y takes some value in this interval, okay, when your y takes a value in this interval, of course your phi of y is going to take some value in what? Your phi of yi minus 1 comma phi of yi. Since your phi is monotonically strict increasing and continuous, because of this you have this one. If it is not monotonically increasing, you will not have this inequality. Actually, you will not have this interval directly. Okay, so this phi of y, I am writing it as x for something. This one we know that it is xi minus 1. This is xi. Of course, your phi of y is going to land in this interval, and this quantity we are designating as x. That's it. Okay, so this is going to happen, means supremum of f of x in this interval is denoted as simply mi. Okay, similarly we can easily prove mi star, small mi star, is same as that of small mi. And now consider delta beta I, which is beta of yi minus beta of yi minus 1, and this is what, alpha of phi of yi minus alpha of phi of yi minus 1, and your phi of y is what, xi, and this is xi minus 1. and this is delta alpha I, right? Thus, what we have is UPG. UPG beta is summation I runs from 1 to n mi star delta beta I, which is summation I runs from 1 to n big mi delta alpha I. This one we write it as UPF alpha. Okay, if you take infimum over the partition, okay, actually here we would have a P star. Infimum over P, it is infimum over P UPG beta, which is infimum over P UP star F alpha. By the continuity of phi, this may be written as infimum over P UP F alpha, and this is what. Okay, this is what we are going to have. From these things, we shall write this as upper integral big A to B G D beta is same as that of upper integral A to B F D alpha. Okay, we mark this as equation 2. And using similar arguments, one can establish lower integral A to B G D beta is same as that of lower integral A to B F D alpha, and let us mark this as equation 3. Given that F is Riemann integrable, this is one of the supposition that we made. Right, so, then what we have, lower integral FD alpha is same as that of upper integral FD alpha is same as that of integral FD alpha. Hence, by 2 and 3, we get integral FD alpha over the limits small a to b is same as that of integral g d beta over the limits big a to big b, and this completes the proof. Thank you.